Father, you open up your word of prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather and to place word freely, to worship you, Lord God, to bring new glory. We ask, Lord, that you would use us, Lord, that you would help us to focus upon your word, Lord God, that you would reveal to us truth, Lord God, and that we would apply it to our lives. Lord, be honored today in everything that we do, from the words that we sing, Lord God, to the words that I preach today, Lord God. Lord, to the thoughts in our minds and our hearts, Lord God, and when we go out from this place, Lord God, use us, Lord. Use us to take some of our lives for your name, for your glory, for your kingdom. We praise and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of all to the fragrance of spring. Every creature you think it was a song that it sings. All exclaiming in this rifle, on the table, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? What's the heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gave source to his lies? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night.
Church at Tubac. I see a lot of new faces, and we're so glad that you're all here, the young and the old. And we have a full house of young children today. Mike got the donuts totally, and that's what we want them to do, is to enjoy their time here and learn about God. We just ask that if you're new and you want to sign a visitor card, they're right in front of your church in the pocket there. So fill them out if you want to go track me, but we encourage you to come back to the church whenever you want to. God calls us to this church, and it's part of our family, and we love it here. My name is Bob. I'm one of the deacons, and I thank Jeremy for his work today as the musical director. And he's going to be also our pastor today, because our pastor is home with his father and his mother as attending to ailing parents like we're all required to do in our lives to support our families. So he'll be back with us next year. Link was in charge of the Sunday school, and he did an amazing job. I think we will probably bring him back for encores. Good teacher, and we all learned from that. I want to thank you all for being here. We have some announcements that for the older people and the studies that are here that were important to them. Awana comes this week, and it's basketball season. I hope everybody in this room knows that it's basketball season. We're not going to let Duke win. I hope that's going to happen anyway. Maybe Kentucky, because Jeremy is from Kentucky, so that would work well for us too. It is here. Worship service is today with Jeremy Wallace, we have a baby bottle campaign. I don't want to say that too many times. Going on, and if you have eye change or you want to contribute to the baby bottle fund, it's for the Arizona Baptist Children's Services, a group here in town that supports young children. We have a lot of agencies in Tubac, Tucson, and Rio Rico and this surrounding area that we really need to support because they do amazing work. Hands of Hope is one of them that helps children out. We sadly have a memorial service this coming Friday for Norm Shoemaker, who passed away last week. He had been battling pancreatic cancer a year and a half. If you believe this, it was a year and a half when he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, stage 4. I was at the hospital with him when the doctors gave him this announcement, told him that he would live 2 weeks. And through the power of prayer and the doctors that were in his attendance, he died a year and a half later. He was a powerful Christian man, and we'll honor that name this coming Friday at 11 o'clock. If you want to attend, please notify Shirley. It's in the bulletins. If you don't have an announcement, hopefully there's some left in the back of the room. We have Easter sunrise service at Jack and Anna Mary's house in Elfinhead on the 1st of April. It's a powerful service that they performed for the last 4 years. Starts, if you read the bulletin, at 6:15, coffee is there. I would suggest find out from Anna Mary or Jack the directions. Elfinhead is out here off of Highway 19. And bring a coat because at 6:15 in the morning, it's pretty chilly out there, and we'll have coffee and donuts in the good old-fashioned way. Right, Jack? The hot stuff. We have a camp that's by Biola University. I don't know much about it, but it's for young children. And if you are interested in sending your children to this camp, please notify Pastor Jeremy next week. A couple other announcements. We had a mission go in yesterday back into Mexico. We feed the children down there every third Saturday of the month. And our group fed yesterday about 115, somewhere in there, kids and their moms. We came back empty-handed and with good filled hearts. So it's a joy that we went. We had 10 people from our church to support this family, and these ongoing contributions are helpful. So we're just blessed to be able to serve down there and help these young children. And we try to get some of our young people down there to exchange in the relationship between young and old, and it's been a blessing for us. I would ask that anybody who wants to go see myself or Chuck or Debbie or Darlene or notify the church or the pastor that you're anxious to or intend to want to fulfill the requirements. I think that's all that I have. We're going to offer offerings here shortly, and we'll pray that this communication between us continues, and we are obedient to the Lord and serve Him as we are all required to do. I'm so grateful that we have so many new people, and I think there's a lot of them here in support of Jeremy and Link, and they are doing a good job. Lincoln is kind of new to our church, but he's a powerful young man. And Jeremy Wallace is in his heart to keep moving forward. His father is a pastor in Tucson, so he's got some good genes in him, and we appreciate all that he does. We'll take up an offering now, and I'd like to pray for this in Christ's name. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessings that you put upon us, Father. We ask that you guide each and every one of us in our hearts through the Holy Spirit, and let the Spirit be active in us and not just sit on our hands as part of a Christian service. We are required by God to do work, to minister, to spread the gospel as best we can, and we share that across the street and into Rio Rico and the surrounding areas. So we ask that these blessings that we are going to offer be put to your use, Father, and for your glory. And we love you and we honor you and we praise your name, Almighty God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand as we continue to worship the Lord. We'll be introducing a new song here called "In Control." The benefit of preaching today is I made it really easy to pick out my songs today for worship. I knew what I was talking about. Well, at least I hope so. So "In Control" is a song that really ministered to me last year, and we're going to be talking, I'll be preaching out of Job, and talking about the sovereignty of God and how He's in control of things that we couldn't even comprehend or imagine. And so the words of this song has really resonated with me, and I hope it really resonated with you. From heaven you look here, I know you're drawing near, as I worship. Within your love, the wind and waves will come, but I will stand here. I lift my hands to heaven, hear my heart surrender, tell my soul again, you are Lord of all. Though the seas are raging, you will speak and tame. You are found my rest. You are in control. All the mountains I will trust. Your spirit is enough to keep me walking. You guide my every step. Speak life to me. Whoa, I need you. I lift my hands to heaven. Hear my heart surrender. I tell my soul again, you are Lord of all. Though the seas are raging, you will speak and tame them. You are found my rest. You are in control. Trust in all of you. No one can answer your perfect.
James 4:13-17. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town, and spend a year there, and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin.
I see the work of your hands. The galaxy spinning, the heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice. All I want is a gentle and thundering voice. Oh God, all that you are is overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I'm running to your
glorious.
church is excused.
2 to 6. Side of leading worship before preaching is my voice is on the edge of leading. I probably shouldn't have sang my heart out, but that's how I sing. So.
Did you need any water, Jeremy?
I got some. Let's make sure it's mine. Testing, testing. Check. Lincoln, you need to see if. Test.
Can you hear me? Here we are. Awesome. All right. So we're going to take a look at the book of Job today. First of all, I want to thank you for the opportunity to come here and preach on behalf of Jeremy. Man, I love this church family. I love you guys. It is an honor for me to be able to preach out of God's word for you guys. And I'm leaving it up to God, because I am nervous, as this is my first time preaching in front of you all. I'm only my second time preaching ever, so judge me on that basis. That's a picture of my son Caspian shortly after he was born. At that age, if you've ever had a newborn, you know that they can only see about a foot in front of them for quite a while. And so the world basically exists of this 1 foot in front of them in either direction. If you're beyond that, you don't really exist to them. They can't really see you, they don't know what's going on. But getting closer, oh, you're in the world. They can see you, they're smiling, they're happy. This is a picture many months later, and this was before he could walk. And naturally, as his eyesight began to develop, he could see further. Eventually, he could see across the room. And you could be sitting across the way, and you could wave to him. He could see you, his eyes would light up. But still, his entire world only consisted of what was in his eyesight. What was in his line of sight was there. Anything outside of it just didn't exist. He had no thoughts about it. So when he's laying down in the living room, looking up at his mobile, he doesn't know what's going on in the kitchen or aware that there even is a kitchen. He doesn't know what we're doing, whether it's getting ready for work or prepping a meal or helping out his sister or a million other things that we could be doing. Naturally, as he grew older, he began to understand things around him and why certain things would happen. Now he's 1 year old and he understands that, hey, there's food in the kitchen. I can go to the kitchen for some food. There's warm milk in the refrigerator. There are food pouches in mom's diaper bag. And so he's able to understand that things exist outside of his view and that he can go certain places and he can do certain things and why certain things happen. But that doesn't take away from the fact that back when he could only see a foot in front of his face, that we, his parents, me and Tatum, weren't taking care of him. We were very much taking care of him when he didn't know it, when he couldn't see it, when he couldn't see past that foot view. We were still working things around him to benefit him. He didn't understand the decisions we had to make or that we could control the thermostat in the house to make it more comfortable, that we chose his clothes out for him, that all the things that we were concerned with, like work and taxes and bills, all the activities we were involved in and juggling and everything that we had to consider when we make our decisions, none of that mattered to him. None of that existed to him. but it didn't take from away from the fact that we were in control. That was his perspective. So I want you to take this idea of perspective as we move into the book of Job. And today we're going to look at God's response to a man that despite having done no wrong, ended up rock bottom, wallowing in the ashes. He would get questioning whether God was even out there, what he was doing. And so we're going to also look very quickly at the end on how God answers him and how we're going to respond, how that response affects our lives as Christians. Job's an amazing book that I could talk about for days, hours, weeks on end. And unfortunately, you guys still want to sit here and listen to me talk for hours on end about the book of Job. So I'm going to try to rush through the story. But I don't want to just sum it up as, well, that's the path of the Job. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Job's story. So we're going to move on to Job 1:1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, and one who feared God and turned away from evil. All right, so right off the bat, we're introduced to Job, upright, God-fearing man. And then we're told about all that he has. There was born to him 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he possessed 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, that was a pair of oxen, so 500 pairs of oxen, and 500 female donkeys, and very many servants, so that the man was the greatest of all the people in the East. You have to say that with the hand gesture. The greatest of all the people in the East. That's how I'm going to refer to Lincoln. Greatest of all people in Southern Arizona. So Job was wealthy, and he was an upright, God-fearing man. And he was only God-fearing on behalf of himself, but in behalf of his family, so much so that verses 4 and 5 talk about how his children would like to feast together. And after their feast, Job would call for them, and he would consecrate them. He'd wake up early in the morning and sacrifice, present burnt sacrifices for each of them. Not because they did any sin, but because they might have cursed God in their heart. Just on the off chance that they did, he would do that every single time. That was the type of man he was. So in the book of Job, we're transported to this heavenly king's court. Right? So these heavenly beings known as the sons of God are gathered there. And among them is Satan, the accuser. And God calls out to Satan, and he presents Job saying, and the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil? And Satan responds, of course Job is an upright God-fearing man. Look at all the stuff he has, man. This guy is loaded. You take away all that stuff, he's going to curse you to your face. And that's not a thought that's far off, because we see in the New Testament, there are several people that want to make Jesus their king simply because of all the stuff they can get, right? For the free food and the miracles. So God says, fine, man, take anything you want away from him, just don't touch Job himself. And so without knowing that any of this conversation takes place between Job and God, Satan and God, Job undergoes one catastrophe after another. A servant comes and reports to him that the Sabians stole the oxen and the donkeys and killed all the servants tending to them. And only he survived to tell Job. And then while that servant was still talking, another servant had come who was tending to the sheep. And so a great fire came and consumed up all the sheep and all the servants tending to them. And only he survived to tell Job. And while that servant was talking, another servant came and said that the Chaldeans had raided them and stole their camels and killed all the servants that were tending to them. And you got to think at this point, 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 pairs of oxen, 500 donkeys, very many servants, all gone in an instant. Devastating. But the way we're introduced to Job, you gotta think that he's the type of man. You might think, oh, well, you know, he could still think, man, this is just stuff. Me and my family are gonna be okay. But while that servant was still talking, another servant comes, and he reports that his children were having a feast like they usually do together, and a great wind came and knocked the house down and killed all of his children, and only the servant survives to tell Job. So now Job has lost everything. Everything is truly gone. all his wealth, all his children. And it's at this point that he tears his robes and shaves his head and falls on the ground and worships. Worships. Saying, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And the Bible goes on to say, in all this, Job did not sin or charge God what was wrong. Man, everything is taken away from him. And he says, man, the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He worships. And so we're brought back to this heavenly king's court, this gathering of the sons of God. And again, Satan is among them. And God calls Satan out again and says, hey, have you thought about Job again? Look at the calamities that have befallen him. And despite that, he's held to his integrity. And Satan responds to him, man, a man will give away anything for his life. I bet you take away his health, he'll curse into your face. And so God allows Satan to take his health. But he tells Satan, don't take his life. Don't kill Job. Job is struck head to toe with sores, and his wife comes by while he's wallowing in the ashes. It says that he took a clay pot, broke in it, and he was scraping at his sores while he was sitting in the ashes. And his wife comes and says, hey, why are you holding on to your integrity? Curse God and die. Well, that's a right? Great words, right? That's the type of advice I expect Tatum to tell me, right? Yes. I'm just kidding. But he rebukes his wife, and the Bible goes on to say, in all this, Job did not sin with his lips. So Job has passed these two seemingly tests that Satan had made these accusations that, hey, he'll curse you to your face, and both times Job has passed this. But he's stuck in this misery for months, and at this point he's depressed and he curses the day he was born. It says he rues the day he was born. He wished he had never seen the light of day in the first place. Everything is gone. He has no health. He is sickly. Then he longs for rest, so much so that he said death would be preferable. At least he would have the company of the dead, and he would be at peace. And here Job's three friends and a man named Elihu, who also ended up weighing in conversation, begins to try to explain why these things are happening to Job. They came there to comfort him. And so they're trying to explain, and all of them basically come to the same conclusion that Job must not be right before God. And therefore he has invited the wrath of God upon himself. But Job argues with them, and he maintains that he's innocent. And Job calls them miserable comforters. They came. All they're doing is making accusations. And they continue to accuse him. And Job contends, at one point, Job contends that, man, there's no correlation between righteousness and prospering. There are so many people, wicked people, prospering. And there's so many innocent, righteous people suffering. He said, there's no correlation between them. That shuts down these arguments of these people that just because he's suffering these things, he must have done something to grieve God. But in his continued effort to defend himself, he put his own innocence and righteousness forward at the expense of God's justice, that he starts saying these wrong statements about God and how his justice is before. He makes these accusations to God, saying that God is not even just. And it's at this point God comes to Job in this mighty whirlwind, this storm. And here God responds to Job. His response in Job is written poetically with these very colorful, lavish words to describe these imagery in front of Job. And we see in God's response, he actually doesn't answer any of Job's questions. These accusations and questions that Job has toward God, God doesn't even mess with. He has something else to say. So let's take a look at God's words. So first he starts off, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man. I will question you, and you make it known to me. This essentially is, put on your big boy pants, Job. I'm going to ask you some questions. You're going to try to answer me. And God begins to take Job on this virtual tour of creation, starting with the earth. In verses 4 through 7, he turns to the earth and he tells Job, "Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Job, if you're gonna question me, were you there when I created all?" You gotta have the answer, right? If you're gonna presume to question me and what I do, or then he turns his attention to the sea in verses 8 through 11. He says, "Or who shut in the sea with doors when it bursts out from the womb and prescribed limits for it?" Job, did you prescribe limits for the seas? Then God turns his attention toward the morning in verses 12 through 15. And he says, "Have you commanded the morning since your days began and caused the dawn to know its place?" Job, who controls the morning? Have you done that? Then God focuses on the depths of the oceans and the expanse of the earth. And he says, "Have you walked the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been revealed to you? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth? Job, have you even been to the bottom of the ocean? And just as much as a mystery, have you even seen the gates of death, let alone what lies beyond death? Have you comprehended the expanse of the earth as I have, Job?" And then God looks up and he points Job upward and he says, in verses 19 through 21, "Where's the way to the dwelling of the light? And where's the place of darkness? You know you were born then, and the number of your days is great. You've been around for a long time. You're a wise man. Tell me. Give me the answer." And God turns his attention toward snow and hail. And he tells Job, "Have you entered the storehouses of snow? And have you seen the storehouses of hail? Have you gathered up the hail, Job?" Let's go even higher. Then God points Job even higher into the heavens, and he says, "Do you know the ordinances of the heavens? Can you establish their rule on earth? Is that beyond your power? Do you even know what you're talking about? Is that too hard for you? Why don't we bring it back a notch, Job? Let's talk about the rain. Can you make it rain, Job?" Verses 34 through 38, "Can you lift up your voice to the clouds that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightnings that they may go and say to you, 'Here we are'? Can you control the weather, Job? It's just the weather. Surely you can do that. It's a piece of cake." And to all these things, God has looked at the earth and the dawn and the snow and the hail and the constellations, rain, lightning, clouds. And the common truth of it all is Job is ignorant of their mysteries. He wasn't there. He doesn't know how it was done. He couldn't even begin to comprehend them or control them. And like Job, this is true of us today. We may know the science of some things, but we have not experienced the deepest, blackest parts of the ocean. We haven't traversed every inch of the planet. None of us have. We haven't the ability to comprehend all of its entirety at the same moment. We weren't there at the dawn of creation, and we did not see with our own eyes how the world was made, or have any hand in making it. We have no authority or knowledge of how to control the weather. So the Lord turns from describing his governance over creation, and then he turns to describe his governance over specific creatures. And he first talks about the lion in Job 38, 39 through 41. He turns Job's attention to the lion. "Can you hunt the prey for the lion or satisfy the appetite of the lion? Do you feed the lions, Job?" Or at the same time, he turns his attention to the goat in 39, 1 through 4, and says, "Do you know when the mountain goat gives birth? Do you watch over the mountain goat high up on the mountain? Are you even aware at this moment? Do you know when it gives birth? Have you watched over the young as he gets strong and grows up and eventually leaves? No, Job, but I do. What about the donkey? Who has let the wild donkey go free? Who has loosed the bonds of the swift donkey, to whom I have given the arid plain for his home and the salt land for his dwelling place? I have loosed the donkey, Job. I have given him the mountains as his pasture." or the wild ox, Job. My daughter likes this verse in the King James because it's a wild ox. It says a unicorn. Is the wild ox willing to serve you? Will he spend the night at your manger? The wild ox is this magnificent, powerful beast, and it was common for them, popular, to hunt these beasts. And so the Lord is saying, can you command the mighty wild ox, Job? Does he listen to your every word? Is he tame to you like he is to me? Well, take these dumb ostriches, Job. This is the little he says, because God has made her forget wisdom and given her no share in understanding. Did you make the dumb ostriches, Job? The ostrich that forgets her eggs on the ground that they might get trampled on or eaten by a predator, or treats her young like they're strangers? I made the dumb ostrich. I made it dumb. But I made her fast. She laughs at the horse and at his rider. I designed these creatures, Job. What about the mighty horse? Do you give the horse's might? Do you clothe his neck with a mane? What about the hawk? Is it by your understanding that the hawk soars and spreads his wings toward the south? Have you instilled in the hawk his instinct? No, Job. To all these things, to all these questions, the answer is no. Job did not make, raise, or feed, or continually watch over all of these creatures throughout the earth. He knows not the moment a mountain goat is giving birth on a mountain far away, at the same time feeding the lions, or understanding that which the hawk does. He didn't design that dumb ostrich. God did. He didn't command the wild ox. God does. He knows not how to control them. Job is ignorant of these things, yet he presumed to question how God was running things. And here Job responds so appropriately, "Behold, I am of small account. What shall I answer you? I lay my hand on my mouth. I have spoken once, and I will not answer twice, but I will proceed no further." God has walked Job through pieces of his sight. Long before Job was born, before any man was born, God made. And he alone made all the creation. He commanded the seas, stretched out the land. He knows and sees the deepest parts of the ocean where no life is. He sees the highest peaks of the highest mountains where no man can climb. He comprehends the entirety of the earth at once. He knows every inch of it. He knows what's going on in every inch of it. Not just where it is, he knows what's happening there. He knows the answers to the mysteries of the universe. He put the stars in the sky. He knows the way to heaven. He knows what lies behind death. The wind, the waves, rain, and lightning obey him. Everything in existence is in his view and under his authority, and nothing escapes his sight. And he further explains this by telling Job about these animals and that he watches and cares for each one of these creatures. Everything in this world was designed, and everything that happens does so with his view, under his view and under his authority. So what does this mean? It means God's perspective and his decisions are infinitely more complex than we can even imagine. Now, we're limited to what we can observe happening in front of us. I can observe what's happening in this world. That is my field of perspective. I can only tell you what's going on in this room. I can't tell you what's going on with the plants and the animals, even just right outside this building. I can't tell you about the squirrel that's on the tree out there, where it came from, where it's going, where its family is, but God does. I can't tell you what birds are flying over us at this very moment, where they came from, where they're going, what their history is, but God does. God knows what's going on in my life. He knows what's going on in your life. He knows knows what's going on in Madera, Canyon. He knows what's going on in Tucson. He knows what's going on in the people's lives in Phoenix, all over the state of Arizona, all over California, all over the United States, all over Canada, all over South America, Europe, the entire world, and every single place in it, all at once. This very moment. He knows what's going on the International Space Station. He knows what's going on the Moon and Mars, on the other side of the universe, at this moment. It's all in his view at all times, under his authority at all times. Now, when we make decisions, we consider the effects as well as we can, as we can understand them, how they relate to ourselves and the people around us. So when I make a decision, for instance, if I were locking up this building and I were to go decide, okay, am I going to shut off the church lights? I'm going to take a look and see if anyone's here. I'm not going to leave anybody in the dark. If no one's here, I'm going to shut the lights off. If people are still here, I'm going to leave them on. I'm going to see if somebody else can close up the church. To make that decision, I observed what was around me, what could I could see, and then I made the decision. That's all I have to work with. God, when he makes a decision, he sees everything, he remembers everything perfectly, and understands everything perfectly that's happened since the dawn of creation. He sees and understands everything that's happening currently in this exact moment. And he knows and understands everything that's going to happen in the future. And with that perfect knowledge and understanding, he makes these decisions. And he knows the effects any one decision has on every person, creature, and thing created in the world. We couldn't even begin to comprehend the complexity of God's wisdom, and therefore the complexity of God's decisions, and the things he is working together at any one moment. This is part of what we mean when we talk about the wisdom of God. Who can comprehend the wisdom of God? So how are we to say things how things should be run? Who are we to tell God how he should do things? None of us have the knowledge that he has. None of us has the authority that he has, the might that he has, the righteousness that he has. Then we see God continue his response to Job, telling Job again to put on his big boy pants. He's going to ask Job some more questions. And we can ask an interesting question based on these verses. We'll read them here. Job 48 through 9. Will you even put me in the wrong? Will you condemn me that you may be in the right? Have you an arm like God? Can you thunder with a voice like his? This presents an interesting question. Is God right just because of his might? Is what makes God right and good that he's stronger than anybody and no one else can knock him down? Is he the biggest and the strongest? Is that what determines right and good? John Piper, in a sermon, Job, the Revelation of God and Suffering, he asked this very same question here, and this is what Piper has to say. I like his answer. I think the answer to that question is yes and no. On the one hand, there is a greater reality that God, with which we can judge, on the one hand, there is no greater reality than God with which we can judge God's actions. He would not be God if he submitted to someone outside of himself. But on the other hand, when we say the sentence God is good, or God always does what is right, God wants us to mean more than simply God is God. He wants us to see that his might does not make right in the sense that it could be capricious or arbitrary and irrational and nevertheless right. Instead, he wants us to see that his might is purposeful. In other words, yes, there is no one stronger or mightier than God. So therefore, he is subject to no one. No one can say what is right over what God says because he is the strongest. He is the mightiest. He is the supreme authority. But like Piper says, God doesn't want us to see that his might makes right, as if God could have mood swings and wreak havoc at one moment or do something else on a whim, and we have to call it right because it's God. God wants us to see that his might is purposeful because it accomplishes good. We see this in these next set of verses. Job 40:10-14. Adorn yourself with majesty and dignity. Clothe yourself with glory and splendor. Pour out the overflowings of your anger and look on everyone who is proud and abase him. Look on everyone who is proud and bring him low and tread down the wicked where they stand. Hide them all in the dust together. Bind their faces in the wall below. Then I also acknowledge to you that your own right hand can save you. God describes here, can you do what I do? This is what I do. I use my might to bring the proud low, and thereby the humble, I raise them up. I adorn myself with glory and splendor and majesty. So God is saying he uses his might to accomplish good. And therefore, when he brings the proud low and lifts up and exalts the humble, we can say God is good. So Job at this point is left with really no answers to his questions. And I don't think he's going to ask them again. But what he is left with is the knowledge that he can trust the Lord in his wisdom, that regardless of the turmoil he's facing, God in his infinite wisdom is in control. This infinite wisdom should make us weak in the knees and make us respond like Job does. You know, behold, I have a small account. What shall I answer you? So really quickly, before we close, so how does this important revelation that God is in absolute control affect our lives as believers in Christ? Well, before I give you, I think, 4 points here that I want to touch on. Let's first deal quickly with some bad doctrine that we could come out of this. Let me tell you what God's sovereignty doesn't mean. God always being in control over everything does not mean that he is to blame for the sinful actions of people. Our sin plus God in control never equals God is responsible for our sin. And let me give an example, a limited example of this, with me and my daughter. I've allowed my daughter to make certain mistakes that would get her in trouble or cause an issue for her in order to teach her. She was making a mistake while under my authority, of which I had the ability to stop her. I was in control, but her actions are her own. The consequences of her decisions belong to her. She gets in trouble for what she did, because she willingly chose to do that. Could I have stopped her from doing it? Yes, I was in control. I could have prevented her from making that mistake, but she made the mistake, and the consequences of her actions are her own. I did it because I chose to use her disobedience in my will. What was my will? My will was for her to grow in wisdom and understanding, so I chose to use her disobedience to do that. But if she would have obeyed and not disobeyed, I would have used her obedience to accomplish my will. Now, that's a very limited understanding of how God works, but the same is true. Because you perform sinful actions, God still chooses to use your sinful actions to accomplish his will. Just because God is in control of every situation and nothing happens without him, allowing it to happen does not mean he's to blame for our sin. We're to blame. God is sovereign over our sin. He chooses to use it. So if you or another person or I sin, we are guilty of that sin. But that's not going to stop God from accomplishing his purposes. We see this in Isaiah 46:8-11. Remember this and stand firm. Recall it to mind, you transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God, there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will accomplish all my purpose. Our disobedience, our sin, doesn't stop him from accomplishing. accomplishing his purposes. He uses even our disobedience. So going back, so what does it mean if God is in control? What does that mean for us as Christians? It means we can have great joy in knowing God is sovereign, bringing in about the means of our salvation. Acts 4, 24 through 28. And when they heard it, they lifted their voices together and said, "Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them," let's get down to verse 27, "for truly in this city they were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. Both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place." Can you think of a greater sin than betraying the Son of God himself and bringing him to death? God was sovereign over their sinful actions and used it in his glorious plan. He is in control. Nothing escapes his sight. The second thing it means is we can love sacrificially. If God is in control, we can love sacrificially. We are called to love the people of God's church and the people outside of God's church. And how is that possible without the risk of us getting hurt? How is that possible without suffering? How is that possible? How are we supposed to have the strength to do good to people that don't do good to us? 1 Peter 4:19. "Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good." If we suffer while obeying God, we can do so entrusting our souls to a faithful Creator, knowing He is loving and faithful and in control. We can do good and be self-sacrificing, knowing that nothing that can happen to us can separate us from our faithful God who loves us and the plans that He has for us. The third thing it means is we can be unafraid in our witness. Matthew 10, 28 through 31. "And do not fear those who can kill the body, but cannot stand up, cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not. Therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows." God is in control. God is sovereign over which bird is going to fall to the ground at one time. And so much so, are you more valuable than that sparrow worth a half a penny? You are more valuable, so much so that God has numbered the individual hairs on your head, or lack thereof. And nothing is going to happen to you that's outside God's good and glorious will. Our God, who is working all things for our good, Romans 8:28. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to His purpose. We can be unafraid of our witness. We can go out knowing that whatever's going to happen to us is going to happen to us under God's control. Nothing is going to come past God's view. God's not going to be like, "Oops, let that one go by me." God has got it under control. Everything is accomplishing His purposes. And His promise to you is that for those who love God, all things work together for good, according to His purpose. Does that mean you're invincible? Does that mean you will never die? Does that mean you will never get hurt? No. But it means you'll never be outside of God's will, God's glorious plan. And you'll get hurt when it serves the glory of God, when it's good. It can still be considered as good. We will die, and it will still be considered as good because it will be in the moment God had planned it for His glory. Finally, it means we can face any situation with supernatural strength of the Holy Spirit and trust in God. If God is in control, we can face literally, all of you, Chris Traeger, literally anything. The secret of living amid life's difficulties is simple. Philippians 4, 12 through 13. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Him who strengthens me. Trusting God, the God who is in control, we can face pain, we can face hunger, we can face devastation, we can face depression, we can face tragedy. And the secret is trust in the God who is in control. Trust in His promises given to us through Christ Jesus. Whatever evil befalls you, whatever sickness consumes you, whatever sorrows wash over you, you can face it because your God is in control. And His purposes are good, and His promises are never failing. And we can face the hardest times when you lose a child, when you lose a husband, when you lose a wife, when you lose a father or a mother, or when you lose a grandfather or a grandmother, or when you lose a brother, or when you lose a sister. You can trust in a God from whose sight nothing can hide. You can trust a God whose great plan will not be thwarted. You can trust a God who has promised to work everything for good. You can trust a God who is sovereign over what feels like chaos. You can trust a God whose love for you, you can never be separated. Romans 8, 31 through 39. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also Him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised. Who is at the right hand of God? Who indeed is interceding for us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long, we are regarded as sheep to slaughter. No! In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, or things to come, nor powers, nor heights, nor depths, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. God is in control. I came pretty close to Pastor Jeremy's time. Sorry about that. We'll skip it in a song. Know that God is in control. No matter what you're going through, whatever the circumstances you face, we serve a God whose promises we can abide in, whose love we can abide in. You don't have to worry. You don't have to fret. Where's your next paycheck coming from? That may be a question you ask, but God's going to feed you. God's going to take care of you. It may look weird to you, but God's going to do it. You're so much more important than a sparrow. But He knows what's going on in the sparrow's life. He knows what's going on in that squirrel's life. You are more important than these things. And you are more importantly in Christ. So everything will work to good and His purpose. So go out today knowing that. Live your life knowing that. Nothing can be against us because God's in control of everything. Close us on a word of prayer.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the truth that Jeremy shared today. The truth that we learned through the book of Job, that
Nothing can separate us from your love, even in the midst of circumstances that are beyond our comprehension. Your word is true, your promises are good, your love is everlasting. Help us to live our life with that perspective. And thank you so much for today and for this time we could spend together in your word. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good job, Jeremy.
Actually, when we met on Thursday, only one.